Now, ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to introduce Mr. Thembalihle Baloyi. Thembalihle Baloyi is a cost and management accountant by training, but an inspirational creative who has got immense perseverance. And I say so because I learned a while ago when we invited him to address our young ones that are part of the Alan Gray Orbis Foundation, that his perseverance spans both personally and professionally. Currently, he's a founder of and executive director of Discovery Inshore, and it's an initiative that he spent a full 10 years working on. Now, I'm not sure how many of us can hold on to an idea and fashion it for that long without giving up. And he has done that. And he, of course, people drawing from his leadership expertise, they've invited him to serve on quite a number of boards of entities. And it's always a pleasure to listen to him, whether he talks about the conceptualization of the product being that we now know as Discovery Inshore, or he speaks about his other passions. I think it was quite befitting that we would invite him because the theme of the Leadership Summit is entrepreneurial leadership. One of the other things that you may not know about him is that in 2012, he got what they call the, the green number. And the green number is accorded to somebody who has run at least 10 Comrades Marathons. So a number of you look up to you, and I'm inspired on that front. And I'm sure that you will have a lot more people wanting to speak to you during lunch, just to have your blessings rub off on them so that they will just finish one, at least one Comrades Marathon. But ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Mr. Thembalihle Baloyi on stage as he talks about building skyscrapers in RSA. And we'll allow you to slowly come up, sir, because we see that you are challenged, but nonetheless, we're here.
Recall the statement that was made by JFK is that he said, we will go to the moon before the end of this decade. And if I recall very well, I think it was 3 years before the end of the decade. And he said, we'll get to the moon before the end of the decade. But there's something very powerful about that statement. It was not complete. That was not a full, complete statement. He said, we know it's difficult to get to the moon by the end of this decade. It brings me to a crucial element of this conversation. Building skyscrapers is incredibly difficult. You can't be in denial about it. You should be fully knowing that when you get into an environment of building skyscrapers, it's a difficult task. But what I like about what JFK had to say, we know it's difficult to get to the moon by the end of the decade, but we're definitely doing it precisely because it's difficult to do so. Did you hear me? We're doing it precisely because it's difficult to do so. When I say Your Excellency will make a way for you, it's because it's difficult, particularly in this competitive world. If you look at what Alan Knopp-Craig was talking about, Silicon Valley is there. There's an incredible amount of funding available for those entities. They can just throw money into making things happen. When you have to have frugality in the things that you do, it's incredibly challenging. And so we've got to have that sober-minded perspective about the things that we need to do. Going into business is an incredibly exciting thing for me. And in fact, for those who don't know, and you probably think I'm crazy to share this with you, but I'm going to share it. It's a personal story. Whether you agree or disagree with it, it was my personal experience. I got into business knowing very well where I come from and what informed me to get involved in business. For me, getting into business was not an accidental thing. It was not a fluke. I was raised by a grandmother, and in that household I had my cousins with me. And my grandmother was not incredibly educated, but she had a Form 3. A Form 3 was crucial those days because it allowed you a couple of things. You were better off than many people who only had a Form 1 or a Standard 5. And then number two, you knew how to read. But there's also another thing that comes with education, and being at a business school like this, I'm excited because I love education. I love what it stands for. I wouldn't be standing here in front of you had it not been for my grandmother's Form 3, which subsequently led to my mother's qualifications. She had a desire to be a doctor. She didn't become a doctor because there was no funding, but she ended up being a teacher, which then pulled the family out of a very dire situation, a very poor community. We've got out of that dire situation mainly because of the power of education. And I know there are a lot of unemployed graduates, so I'm not in denial about that. There are a lot of unemployed graduates in the country. But the moment you commence with this thought process that says we can build skyscrapers and our excellence will make a way for us, I think it changes the game in a very dramatic way. It changes the game in such that your imagination, the kind of liberated, you start seeing the possibilities that a number of people typically would not be able to see. Someone made a very interesting comment, a good friend of mine. He said, well, it was his wife actually. She said, education gives you that level of sophistication when you deal with issues. And when you talk about sophistications, I'm not talking about being aloof. I'm not talking about being inaccessible. I'm not talking about being arrogant, looking down upon people. When I'm talking about sophistication, I'm talking about the ability to connect complex concepts, to take things that are completely unrelated, as you would find out that Discovery Shore was actually born out of a completely unrelated industry. It was born out of the ability to connect all these things and bring them together and create opportunities to do something unique and exciting. And that's the thing about education. And so the story goes back to when I was about 5 years old. I know this because it was before I started school and I did go to the creche, preschool, whatever you call it. I already had this desire and this understanding that I'll be involved in business. She was born out of that grandmother who had this understanding that as much as she was not uber educated, but she could still make a difference for her grandchildren and for her children. And the key thing here was that I grew up thinking she was my mother, as many kids in our communities grow up with their grandmothers, and they somehow always thought those were their mothers until they become of age, and then you realize that you're actually dealing with your grandmother. And the good thing about my grandmother is that she was very enterprising, and her enterprising spirit was such that when there's no food on the table, she always had a way of gathering the young people around the village, bringing them together so that we can have something to put on our stomachs. And so when I look at that capacity to harness different factors of production and then be able to produce something of substance, produce value, it then dawned upon me. Because I lived in a village between Newcastle and Dundee, and we had to take these buses to Newcastle or to Dundee or to Danausa, which were always packed like sardines. And I had a fundamental problem with it. But that was the only option we had. And it dawned upon me that one day, if my grandmother can facilitate the appropriate resources to make things happen, one day I'll own a bus company and we'll solve this problem of being packed like sardines. And as I got a bit older, I got to realize that my uncle was working in a mine. And the dream was born. This was before BEE. The dream was born. I was probably 7 or 6, thinking, one day I'll own a business, mining business, that will be so profitable. And why am I sharing this? It's because those are the fundamental basics and fundamental starting points of why I'm here, where I am today. And a dream was born, and this dream was out of consistent conversations with my grandmother, where I knew that you need to make a difference in the society. That was her language. You've got to do things that make a difference in the society. Fast forward to 2013, I bumped into Adrian Gore. Many of you know him. He's a well-celebrated business leader in this country. He had just delivered one of those beautiful speeches that he always does about the prospects and the future of this country. And that is why, for me, it also plays out very strongly when I talk about skyscrapers. The mentality of building big things, the mentality of doing things that have impact, mentality of building things that change the world. So I said to him, and it was September 2003, I remember very well, I said, beautiful speech, Adrian. This is another thing, guys, that I want to emphasize. Authenticity. Crucial. You've got to be authentic in the way you tell your stories, in the way you give feedback. Because your authenticity, people will read and understand and will embrace it. You know, I get so many pitches coming through in my office, people coming up with all sorts of ideas. I know when it's authentic, and I know if it's just a job. So here I was, naive. Possibly I could have been fired for the comment that I made to Adrian. And it helps to be naive, by the way. Those are the key ingredients of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is of such a nature that your naivety helps you to see opportunities that many people will completely outright dismiss. And say, no, this is never going to happen. But here I'm saying, Adrian, I love your speech, authenticity, because I meant it. All the more reason I want to go out and do my own thing. And he turns around and he says to me, wow, that's quite interesting. What is it that you want to really do? And I'll go back to that thing I told you about my grandmother always having a vision, always having a capacity, always having a perspective that you can do something that can make a difference. And I say to him, by the way, I grew up with this vision that one day I'll build organizations or businesses or institutions, whatever type of institution, that really fundamentally makes a difference in the world. And he turns around and he says to me, wow, I love that vision. So instead of going out there on your own, why don't you find something to do with us? Let's find something to do together. So I go on this journey of trying to find something that we could do together. But I just want to underline something. And it was mentioned, I think, by Craig, Alan, not Craig, earlier on. You need partners along the way. Getting partners along the way solves a problem of capacity, but also it creates an opportunity for you to get additional ideas. If you are on your own, even when there is a big blind spot, you will not be able to identify it. But when you've got people around you, it helps a great deal. So I encourage entrepreneurial people to say, yes, you've got this dream, you've got this vision, it's precious to you. You have the capacity to take a risk. And the risk is to bring partners. And let me be just frank with you. With partners, there is no guarantee that you'll get a good partner. With partners, chances are you might get the wrong person who will derail you completely. And you end up in a field of bankruptcy. Hopefully it doesn't happen to you. But the reality is you've got to be open to these possibilities. You've got to be open-minded to the prospect of this thing going completely wrong. Recently, I mentored quite a number of young people. One of my mentees is in Hong Kong at the moment. And he's got this beautiful opportunity. He's a South African guy. He's been in Hong Kong for a number of years. And he's got this beautiful opportunity to start a business that's going to spread throughout the eastern part of Africa. And so he phones me and he says, I need your guidance. And I says, okay, I'll give you my guidance because I've known you for years. But I want to put up a disclaimer. And the disclaimer is that I love uncertainty. And that's one thing I found about entrepreneurs. They love uncertainty. And the reality of uncertainty is that it happens to all of us. Life is not certain. We don't know what's going to happen tonight. Hopefully nothing dramatically negative happens. But we don't know what's going to happen tonight. So what happens if that very thing that you were not expecting happens tonight? A lot of people get paralyzed. They don't respond to those uncertain moments. And so for me, my request and my guidance and my encouragement to you is that you must embrace uncertainty. Maintain that element of being naive, and naivety produces incredible ideas and incredible opportunities. And also, appreciate that ideas come from the unlikely places. As I said to you earlier on, the power of education is of such a nature that you become sophisticated and you can put ideas together from every possible aspect of life. And the Birth of Discovery show was of such a nature that I was simply watching Discovery Channel. And remember, I had already declared to Adrian in 2003, I want to do something. I've given him sort of like a brief idea of what I want to do. And one day, 2006, watching Discovery Channel, bam, something beautiful happens. I'm seeing this obsession with plane crashes. It's a bad thing to be talking about it because I'm still going to fly back to Johannesburg. But I see this obsession with the black box when the plane has crashed. And I start asking myself questions, why are they so obsessed with black boxes? And aha, something powerful about the black box. It's used mainly for three things. To reconstruct the scene of an accident or of a crash. To understand exactly what led into it. Number two, it's used for training of pilots so that they can be better equipped. Number three, it's used for manufacturers so that the manufacturers can create safer aircrafts. So, you might say to me, how is this related to motor insurance? Very much so, and that is the power of education and sophistication that it brings along to interrelate things that are completely unrelated. It's simple. After a crash on the road, typically someone will come and draw lines and then will tell you they are reconstructing the scene of your crash. But with the aviation technology that's already available, which is the black box, they can actually go into the recording and reconstruct the actual crash, the events leading up to that crash. And then it sparked another idea. How is it possible that the Formula One circuit, vehicles traveling at more than 300 kilometers per hour, the fatality rate is less than 0.002. How is that possible? And guess what? It's the black box technology. They know exactly what's happening on that pitch as the driver takes the corners at whatever speed. And so why are we not using that technology? Remember, I've got a black box that I've just discovered from watching plane crashes. Then I'm trying to figure out who's actually got that technology that is using in the motor vehicle industry. And that's when I realized that, okay, in South Africa we've got perhaps the advantage that you guys see as a negative. And the advantage, which is also a negative, is that we've got a high theft rate of vehicles in this country. And as a result, many companies or many insurance companies will insist that you must have a tracker in your vehicle. And so that tracker in your vehicle, what other technology does it have? And if it doesn't have, where do we get the technology? And that's how the idea was born. I'm just sharing with you the power of education, the sophistication element, the ability to put things together. So let me go to a couple of questions that every entrepreneur must deal with. Top of mind, I've got just four questions. Top of mind, you need to know why you're doing the things that you're already doing. Why are you entering this industry? And it goes back to what Bonang was talking about. And I can simplify it for you. And I say it's a question of purpose. It's a question of purpose. Who am I? And why am I doing these things that I'm doing right now? Others would call it vision. Others would call it whatever they call it. But I often prefer to call it a question of purpose and self-governance. And as academics, those who are academics in this room, we probably call it self-mastery. But it boils down to that ability to answer this simple question, why am I doing the things that I'm doing? Is it purely for money, or am I solving a social problem, a genuine social problem? Let me take you back to my thinking and my experiences. It was in 1989, I remember very well. So about 20-something years ago, 26 years ago. If you think about it very carefully, I get into this class, and this is the power of education, guys. I'm just, you know this. A lot of people are doing it to pass. They're not doing it to know, deeply know, a certain type of knowledge. So I'm doing economics, and business economics in Standard 8. Those were the early days when we had the opportunity to start with economics and business economics in Standard 6. Something fascinates me about the factors of production, particularly about the entrepreneur. Who's an entrepreneur? I'm not talking about a tetrapreneur, I'm talking about an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is someone who harnesses the factors of production and solve a genuine social problem in a profitable way. It's as simple as that. That was the definition. And I could identify with that guy that was being defined and described there. And the question is, while you sit in this room, with all the opportunities you have, the things you are doing, the exposure you're getting, can you identify with that guy who solves a genuine social problem in a profitable by organizing the four factors of production? Are you that type of a person? Are you willing to deal with labor? Are you willing to look for capital? Are you willing to look for the technology and the resources that are required, materials or whatever the case may be? So that for me resonated. To me, that was me. I could identify with that guy. He is an entrepreneur. The guy that looks at the problem and say, we can solve this problem and we can solve it profitably. Let me underline why profitably is important. If you are solving a problem and you don't have a source of income to self-sustain, you are in trouble. Because you're going to close shop eventually. When you are solving a problem and there's a clear business model that shows you how this thing is going to work. And by the way, I just want to make a big disclaimer. I'm a strong believer, and guys, if I shoot me, you are more than welcome to do so. I'm a strong believer that the government is not going to solve the problems. Problems are supposed to be solved by entrepreneurs like you and I. Government takes along to enable us, for instance, when you're talking about the issues of infrastructure, which is expensive. But you and I are the people that are going to determine how to solve the problems. Why? Because you and I can solve it more efficiently. And you and I have to solve it in a profitable way. And to solve it in a profitable way means it can be efficient. You're not hearing me. I'm disappointed. Are you with me?
Yes.
I'm very disappointed you are all quiet. Eddie, I hope I'm not offending you. And then of course, Where do I want to go? It's a second question. The first question I said, why am I doing the things that I'm doing? That's a key question of purpose. The second question that every entrepreneur must answer is, where do I want to go? I've been very clear in the past that if you don't know where you want to go, everything that comes along will disturb you, will distract you. We all get distracted, including myself. In fact, when Alan was talking about being focused and speaking about getting married, I was fortunate, I also got married young, so I stayed focused. Here's another thing about getting married and about being an entrepreneur. And I know it's exciting to see all these opportunities coming along. There's one thing I want to highlight. Focus is underrated. And I'll tell you, focus is probably the most powerful thing. When you were doing the intro there about the 10-year journey, it's incredibly painful. But when you're focused, things do happen. It's very important. And then the next question I'm going to ask, which is probably the most important one, and you guys are all going to confront it. I don't care who you are. You're going to confront this question. Question number three. What am I going to do when I have to face rejection, failure, and possibly a sense of ridicule? Because you might be ridiculed for your idea. Someone will tell you you're smoking something very strong. Sit down, you're smoking your socks out. This whole idea you're bringing to the party is just never going to work. In fact, it reminds me of a conversation I had with someone yesterday. And a very strong lady, very educated, master's, possibly doing her PhD already. And she tells me, I feel defeated. And I said to her, what leads to this feeling of being defeated? Then she started giving me a lot of reasons. But here's the point about the statement of feeling defeated. I'm not going to lie, I've gone through it. There were moments when I felt completely defeated. But here's what is important. What happens when you're in that moment of feeling defeated? Do you embrace it and seek for opportunities to emerge out of it? Or do you dismiss it and start beating yourself down? It's a key question. When you're feeling defeated, when you feel rejected, when you feel that all the things you were planning to do are not coming together the way you thought they would, what do you do? I call it embracing failure. Not because you're embracing failure to fail. You're embracing failure to learn out of it and to emerge stronger and more powerful. Because you will fail. You may fail on a small deal or you may fail on a big deal. But what do you do when that happens? Finally, what am I going to do right now to move forward, to make this thing happen? Because we can talk about the theoretical elements, we can come up with an idea, but if you're not going to act on it, nothing's going to happen. What am I going to do right now to make it happen? So, I don't know how much time do I still have, but I can wrap up now and allow space for questions. But these key questions, if they are not answered, the four questions, which I hope, I don't know how many of you remember, but if they are not answered these four questions, you are in trouble. You're commencing a journey underprepared. You're commencing a journey with a high risk of uncertainty in the environment which you will not be able to handle when it materializes. So on that note, I just want to say thank you. And I do hope that you being here today is going to emerge, something out of you is going to emerge, is going to make a huge difference in this community. Because that's what entrepreneurs are supposed to do. Identify problems, solve those problems, but solve them in a very profitable way. So I want to say thank you very much. It's been a pleasure. I truly appreciate it. And by the way, just to let you know, these conversations are not by the way. These conversations are powerful in their design because someone challenged me in 2002 and said, is there still space for short-term, another short-term insurer? And it was just a conversation. And guess what? We launched it in 2011. I'm glad to say today, she's actually launching a similar type of an insurance company in a couple of weeks' time. And I'm very pleased that the conversation that was so simple as, is there another space for another insurer, has led into the possibilities. And the possibilities are always going to be there. Thank you so much.
For somebody that doesn't know what this discovery insurance is,
in just 2 or 3 minutes, if you could just share what is this product that you did develop? Why was it so important? What was the gap in the market that you were responding to? Before we open up for the round of questions.
So at a high level, Discovery Insure is a motor insurance product which is deeply focused on keeping you safe on the road, making you a better driver, because the evidence is there. As I said, Formula One is a classic example. If you are a better driver, you are very likely not to be involved in an accident, and if you do get involved in an accident, it's not going to be as severe as someone who is maybe taking off very aggressively on the traffic lights. By the way, PE won the best town when we did the driver challenge in 2014. They were the best drivers out of this town. So we like that. We like that because it means you guys have got a certain level of understanding that driving carefully and cautiously is going to prolong your life.
So it means we don't need Discovery Insurance.
No, you actually still do. I'll tell you why. Because the younger people are the majority that are dying. And they're dying out of unnatural causes. When we talk about unnatural causes, we're talking about road crashes in the majority. And those are the people in their prime. And if you look at the statistics and you start drilling down and look at the numbers, those are the people who have just started taking off in their careers. They bought their first vehicle or second vehicle, probably bought a very powerful machine, GTI or a 3-series, whatever the case may be, and then they die. The economic loss to the country is about 307 billion per annum. And I just think it's unacceptable. And that was the premise in which the Discovery Insure was born.
Sure. I thought it was important that you share that because somebody may have a question that's related to trying to match this longevity that's required in developing a product over such a long time, and how do you spot that gap and respond to it? What are those drivers? Ladies and gentlemen, this is the opportunity that you have to ask Themba any questions, or if you found anything that resonates in those 4 questions that you spoke about. It's an opportunity for a point of reflection on our side. Are there any hands? Yes, I note one there. Would you like to take another one if there is one? Okay, if not, let's just go with you, sir. Introduce yourself and then ask your question.
Okay, thanks. My name is Sia. I'm from the Insight newspaper. My question would be that there were a lot of young in this country who are innovative in terms of creating or coming up with new ideas. What would your advice be regarding protecting them in terms of intellectual property, patent, and their innovations? Because as well, now sometimes you come up with an idea and then you go to these financial institutions to submit a business plan and ask for funding. Or you know your idea is being rejected and sold this business plan. But somewhere along the line, you resurfaced elsewhere within the metro, and it's viable, and you could see that this was actually my idea. So how would you advise, or what would you advise me in terms of helping people protect their innovations and their ideas when they come up with that's my question today.
I'm going to give you an unconventional response, because I just had this conversation on Sunday with someone who really wants to bring a very innovative idea to the market. And they asked me exactly the same question. And I responded in a way that they were completely unsatisfied. And I think you will be unsatisfied as well. But it's the truth. And the truth of the matter that I'm going to bring to you, if you don't believe me, go and read the biography of Benjamin Franklin. And I think you can see already where I'm going with it. He never patented anything. Some of his ideas were implemented along the way by many people. But until today, we all know the majority of those ideas came from Benjamin. And the point I'm making, the point I was making to the young man on Sunday was, listen, the call is yours ultimately. The moment you go with an NDA, come up with a non-disclosure agreement, entering my office or entering anyone's office for that matter, you must know, they'll never even consider helping you. They won't even want to listen to you. So you're taking a risk. It's uncertain, as I said earlier on. Taking a risk, walking into someone's office, you don't have a non-disclosure agreement. But that point that Bonang was talking about there, point of trust, you are hoping that you're entering into a conversation with someone who's going to develop an element of trust with you. And I know, I'm not talking theory here, I've gone through it personally. We have shared an idea with someone, someone takes it and they go and they implement it. It's fine. The reality is that they will never implement it exactly to the extent that I have conceived it. I know that for a fact. What is in your mind and what you have as a formation of your idea, they can steal it, but they cannot do it exactly to the same extent. In fact, even with Discovery and Show, by the way, I think 18 months before we launched, I won't mention the name of the company, they had heard about what I was doing, because the word always goes around, and they went and they launched 18 months ahead of me. Do you know it only lasted 24 months and it died? And the point I'm making is, ideas are everywhere, by the way. Ideas will always be available. But when you've got that DNA of what you want to deliver, no one can do it exactly like you. So you must never be hung up and never be discouraged by the possibility that someone stole your idea. They've done that, and there are many other ideas that I've been working on that people have taken when I share with them. And it's up to them, it's fine. But the reality is they will never do it exactly the way that I've conceived it. I know you're probably not satisfied because you were expecting me to say go and patent it. You were expecting me to say go get lawyers. The moment you commence with lawyers, you must know that the trust is broken from the word go. It won't give you a light of day. But the call is yours ultimately. You can go and start with lawyers. I can tell you right now, chances are they won't even allow you in the door.
Thank you. There's another question there. Over to you, sir. If you can just take the mic to him.
Good morning, Robert. My name is Raymond Geisha. I am an owner of an engineering and ICT business. And I have a question for you. How many executives in the corporate space, as a percentage, do you think have the guts, as it were, to be builders of skyscrapers and not just people that occupy a position for the sake of just doing what they have to do within a corporate space? From my personal experience, is I see a lot of corporate companies with people that carry the executive tag, but do not exactly understand skyscraper builders, if I can call it that, for lack of a better word. But I wanted to hear from you, as a percentage of executives in the country, how many do you feel are the skyscraper builders and people that are willing to take things to the next level?
It's an important question. And I'll tell you, perhaps that's why I'm also here, and that's why I entitled Building Skyscrapers, because my observation has been that less than 10% of executives are skyscraper mentality people. And it's such a disappointing observation when you start to engage, because in fact there's a guy from Cambridge, Professor Willis, who had a very interesting conversation with me. And he says a lot of executives are not thinkers beyond the execution. They are just executors, that's why we call them CEOs, Chief Executive Officer. They are not called Chief Creative Officer, because their ways of thinking are more about executing. And there's room for executors, it's crucial, we need it in the economy. But I just want you to go with that understanding that a shortage of creative people and skyscraper builders does not mean that you should not be one. In fact, there's a statement that I love with all my heart. There's value in rarity. Because they are rare, you guys need to be thinking about becoming skyscraper builders. Because I'm very rare to find. There's value in rarity. That's why diamonds are so expensive. Because they are rare to find. You can't just pick it up on the street. Be that diamond.
My follow-up question to that.
Yes, sure, go ahead.
Is how do we then, as a business owners and a corporate, create space for those creative minds and those creative talents?
It depends on the organization. As in our environment, we've created something called Inspiring Excellence. It's a very formalized program. In fact, tomorrow I'll be spending most of my day adjudicating that process. Where you've got these ideas coming through, and people come and present and tell us what they think is going to work and why do they see this opportunity, is it a game changer, etc., etc. But there's also another reality. As those ideas come through, including my idea, by the way, my idea was rejected 7 times before it launched. That's an important statement that you guys need to hear. Rejection does not mean it's the end of the road. Rejection is an opportunity for you to go back and refine your idea, work on it as hard as you can to come out with something much better than what you had already presented. The reality is tomorrow, probably 90% of those ideas that are going to be presented, I'm going to say it's not good enough. But when you get the word that it's not good enough, it doesn't mean that kaput is finished with you. Go back to the drawing board, put the effort. A lot of guys ask me, how much effort do I need to put forward before I present? I say, put everything you can, because you don't know the level of maturity of your idea, what it will achieve when you present it to someone like me, or someone who wants to look at an opportunity. So you cannot really end up with a situation to say, I'm so paralyzed that I can't put forward my idea. Put forward your idea. And that's the thing I was talking about, embracing failure. Be ridiculed if you have to be ridiculed. But it's an opportunity for you to go and refine.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tenderbonelli. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, if you can just give a round of applause.